Hey, I'm Mac. Welcome back to my channel. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe and consider joining my Patreon for access to new videos 12 to 24 hours early, as well as some Patreon exclusive content. In my last video, we listened to a truly brain-meltingly inane episode of the Rachel Hollis podcast in which she and her energy healer friend spent 45 minutes unintentionally demonstrating the Dunning-Kruger effect and providing a wealth of totally factual information about medicine and health, backed up by gold standard evidence such as wordplay, asserting that it totally happened with this one guy this one time, or that it was printed in one book by a completely unqualified author, recommendations from which have made it into exactly zero clinical guidelines. One of those books touted by Rachel is The Secret Language of Your Body. And while Rachel didn't say why she felt the book was reputable or trustworthy other than seemingly enjoying what it had to say and that it felt true to her, I personally would at least trust the author, Ina Segal, to treat even the most severe case of constipation after seeing Miss Segal's peerless ability to pull things out of her ass. So today we're going to take a look at the most offensive, fact-starved, logic-bereft, jaw-droppingly irresponsible pile of trash and heinous slap in the face to medical science it has ever been my misfortune to encounter, and see what real knowledge looks like. Let's go! So the book actually opens with a bunch of endorsements from supposedly, you know, really reputable people that you really should totally trust, okay? Like, they're just like really great sources. So, I mean, that's why they put the endorsements at the beginning, you know, because you've already bought the book, so you clearly still need to be convinced. I looked into them. I did a little bit of research. So I thought maybe we would, maybe we'd see what was with these endorsements and see who these people are. The Secret Language of Your Body truly is the essential guide to restoring your body to its healthiest state and assisting you to heal your life. Ina Segal offers invaluable insights into the underlying causes of illness and disease and provides practical advice which will undoubtedly empower many to self-heal. So read on and learn from the wisdom of this book, says Bernie S. Segal, who graduated from Cornell Medical University in 1957 and got his surgeon certification in 1962, and who is widely considered to be an extremist. For example, he believes that the immune system can overcome cancer unless you're interfering with it. He also states that self-acceptance and emotional growth is necessary for a strong immune system. Also, I'm sorry, I'm not being ageist here. I'm just saying that practices change dramatically over time, and the knowledge base expands. There's only so much you can stay up to date on with continuing education. 1957, when he graduated from medical school, was a very different world, okay? CPR was invented 3 years after he graduated from medical school. The ultrasound would be introduced 8 years after he graduated from medical school. The first immunosuppressive drug, cyclosporine, was approved for use in organ transplants in 1970, after he had already been practicing medicine for 13 years. While doctors are required to take continuing education, it is worth bearing in mind that the curriculum a recent medical school graduate will have learned is going to be extremely different from the curriculum taught in 1957, and not just in terms of vocabulary and stuff, but also in terms of how to conceptualize the physician role and how to think about evidence and the general receptiveness to input and feedback. In 1957, there was much more of a, if an MD says it, then it's true way of thinking. And it was a lot more common and acceptable for doctors to act based solely on subjective experience instead of scientific evidence and clinical guidelines. Many doctors are very resentful of this. However, we're generally willing to trade a few bruised egos if it means vastly improved clinical outcomes. You know, it's worth remembering that the MD just like the PharmD, Doctor of Pharmacy, or Doctor of Nursing Practice, is not a science degree. It is a professional degree, and it's actually relatively recent that evidence-based medicine became a core philosophy. So next up, we've got Christiane Northrup, who surrendered her medical license to the state of Maine in 2015, is a QAnon follower, rejects the germ theory of disease, and believes that Bill and Melinda Gates are performing biomedical monitoring via the COVID-19 vaccines, and that vaccinated mothers will kill their babies if they breastfeed. Which is certainly an interesting claim to make, given that in the UK, they found that COVID-19 vaccination in pregnancy reduced risk of stillbirth by over 15%. Personally, I find it heartwarming that they are able to put aside their differences and engage in an activity that they both enjoy, okay, even after going through a divorce. So congratulations, Bill and Melinda. On the book, Northrup gushes, "The secret language of your body is thrilling and right on target. My fondest hope is that people all over the world will take this message of healing into their hearts and bodies and become vibrantly well." Next up, quote, "Siegel explains and demonstrates how your thoughts, energy, and emotions affect your health, so your body's wisdom won't be a secret anymore, but a powerful guide to transform every area of your life," raves best-selling author and deadbeat dad Jack Canfield, who wrote Chicken Soup for the Soul several years after he walked out on his wife and two sons to go live with a masseuse in the 1970s. "An easy-to-use practical guide for establishing a relationship with your own body and its healing potential, this book offers you user-friendly tools to participate in your own healing. The Secret Language of Your Body is an inspiring guide for learning to communicate effectively with our own bodies," says Brandon Bays, who claims to have healed a basketball-sized tumor all on her own without treatment or surgery, to which I say, prove it. But of course, there's no proof, and to that I say, liar. Next. "You don't have to be ill to benefit from this remarkable book. Miss Siegel provides simple but powerful exercises that help you connect with your body and inner wisdom to promote physical, mental, and emotional healing at the deepest level, allowing you to live a happy, healthy, more abundant life," says Hyla Cass, who is generally anti-vax in addition to vocally supporting legislation that would strip employers of their right to protect their employees and their business operations by opting to not hire those who choose not to be vaccinated. Next. "I was a skeptic at first look, but I tried it and discovered this to be a magical book. Quite simply, it works and it can heal you," says Roger Cole, whom it lists here as Roger Cole, MD, when he actually is not an MD. He has a Bachelor of Medicine and a Bachelor of Surgery from the UK, which is generally considered to be the UK equivalent of an MD. But it's still not true that he has an MD, and many MDs would take issue with the equivocating. "He's exclusively been practicing palliative medicine since the 1980s, so for nearly 40 years, he has only treated the terminally ill. I don't think I need to spend a lot of time explaining that the needs of patients who are not terminally ill and the needs of patients who are terminally ill are extremely different from each other, and that is a very long time to have been doing one thing. He's been exclusively treating terminally ill patients for longer than I have existed on this earth." Next. "Even if you don't know what's wrong with you yet, this book will help you start on the road to healing, and with the guidance of Ina, maybe eventually even a cure," says Jerry M. Rosenbaum, MD, whom I'm not gonna lie, I started getting very excited about because it said that he was doing all kinds of work on experimental psychiatric treatments involving psychedelics, but then I realized that the doctor I had pulled up was Jerry F. Rosenbaum at Mass General Hospital, because of course it's at MGH. No, this loser just wrote, "What's Wrong With Me? The Frustrated Patient's Guide to Getting an Accurate Diagnosis," with the summary, "The RX for Solving Your Mystery Malady When Your Doctors Can't. listen, doctor, we get enough incomprehensible garbage at the pharmacy that we solve without troubling you. Like when an electronic prescription for a ProAir inhaler comes in and instructs the patient to inhale 1 to 2 puffs every 4 to 6 hours rectally because you don't have time to make sure that you've entered PRN, which means as needed, instead of PR, which means rectally, and 0% of the time have any of your patients received an inhaler with a label directing them to go ahead and puff up the pooper. And we don't say a word to you guys about it, but I swear to God, you want to know what will happen if you send a prescription for a book? Fuck around and find out, doctor. Anyway, this is a premise which, on its face, is a valid feeling of frustration. The problem is that just because someone is frustrated and has been unable to get meaningful answers from their healthcare providers doesn't mean it becomes morally acceptable to begin giving them unprovable, unscientific advice without evidence. If I'm out on a hike and you ask me which way to go to get back to the trailhead, and I've never heard of this trailhead, I should not pretend to know which way is the way there. If you then explain you are very frustrated because you've asked 3 other hikers and they all either said they didn't know or they misdirected you or didn't take enough time to listen to you thoroughly, that does not suddenly change that, even if me knowing the correct way for you to go would make you feel better, because later you are just going to end up lost because I just made something up to make you feel better because you were frustrated. The degree to which my advice is bullshit doesn't depend on how frustrated you are or how many other places you've looked for answers. Next. Livid, pissed off, torn up inside, heartache, bone weary, jaundiced, gut wrenching, blood boiling, pain in the neck, stab in the back, take my breath away, rash decision, sick to death. Our language is alive with ancient wisdom about the origin of many illnesses. The secret language of your body allows you to recognize and set yourself free from the toxic effects of unconscious beliefs and emotions and start on a path to self-healing, says Robin Youngson, MD, who in a recent blog post on his website, Neuroscience of Healing, asserts that the current vaccines do little to slow the spread of COVID, and recent data from the UK shows a higher rate of COVID cases among the vaccinated than the unvaccinated. And then he proceeds to cite a study evaluating the efficacy of COVID-19 vaccine boosters, pointing out that there were just as many COVID-19 infections in the control group as the experimental group, because he does not understand or chooses not to understand that every patient in that study was in fact vaccinated. The study was evaluating the effectiveness of boosters. One might say that our language is alive with ancient wisdom about vaccination, because you can tell that someone receiving a booster was already vaccinated, because if they weren't, there would be nothing to boost now, would there? He also fails to mention that nearly all of the COVID-19 cases in the experimental group in that study were patients who got the VLA-2001 vaccine, which we already knew was not as effective as the Moderna and Pfizer mRNA vaccines. However, the advantages of the VLA-2001 vaccine are that it is a more traditional inactivated whole virus instead of an mRNA vaccine, meaning it could be more economical to manufacture it, in addition to potentially being perceived as more acceptable to those who have concerns about the mRNA vaccines, perhaps due to misinformation being recklessly spread by people like Youngson. No wonder he had to dive way into the corners of this one study to find anything that even sounded remotely like the point he was trying to make, because the numbers are in and they are overwhelming. You are 97 times more likely to die from COVID-19 if you are unvaccinated compared to vaccinated with a booster. In 2021, the European Center for Disease Control estimated that almost 500,000 people over 60's lives had been saved by a COVID-19 vaccination. If you are vaccinated and you still become infected, your odds of developing long COVID are half of what they would be if you weren't. Furthermore, If Mr. Youngzin likes the study so much and is so concerned about the risks of the vaccine, it's certainly baffling that he failed to mention that there was no statistically significant difference in rates of adverse events between the two groups. But I guess that wouldn't have helped him make his point, because that would sound like they're safe. Facts are so annoying like that. And then there's a random psychologist in here that I've never heard of and cannot find any information on. But all I'm going to say is that it is very difficult for me to say the name Mary Ann Gallagher instead of Mary Catherine Gallagher. But I suppose it could be worse. At least her parents didn't name her after bottled water. Okay, so this next one is an interesting one for me, because as an American, I had never heard of this guy, Simon, is it still pronounced Simon if the I in there is geminated? I've never seen that before. Reynolds. He is Australian, works in advertising and communications, and of the book, Simon says, an amazing book from a renowned healer. Think of it as the introduction manual for ultra health of the mind, body, and spirit. The reason this guy is interesting is because apparently in 1987, he created this Australian PSA, and I genuinely, sincerely am ambivalent about it. And I mean the actual definition of ambivalent, a word which does not mean apathetic. It means having two contradicting feelings about something at the same time. Ambivalent, you know, like ambidextrous. Take a look.
First, only gays and IV drug users were being killed by AIDS. But now we know every one of us could be devastated by it. The fact is, over 50,000 men, women, and children now carry the AIDS virus. That in 3 years, nearly 2,000 of us will be dead. That if not stopped, it could kill more Australians than World War II. But AIDS can be stopped, and you can help stop it. If you have sex, have just one safe partner, or always use condoms. Always.
It's certainly very compelling, but doesn't it kind of seem like they're implying that gay men and IV drug users are the Grim Reaper here? I read some interviews and he said that that wasn't the intent, but it really seems like that's what they're implying. I don't know. This guy is still the least terrible endorser so far, by far. Ina shows us how to read and communicate with our body. She has beautifully managed to tap into what is possibly the next frontier for psychologists, the wisdom that our amazing bodies have for us, says Rob Hillier, who is listed here as a registered psychologist, which is odd since according to his own website, he surrendered his license in 2011 so that he could incorporate more of what he calls quantum science into his practice. According to Rob, quantum science is a body of scientific knowledge that explains, among other things, love and connection. It comes with its own version of common sense and challenges traditional scientific logic, often coming up with notions contrary to what we have always believed to be true. The term that is usually applied to this type of misinterpretation of quantum mechanics is quantum mysticism. There is certainly no time for me to dive deep into quantum mechanics, which is good because I really struggle to grasp it. But at the most basic level, quantum mechanics is the study of matter, energy, and their interactions at the atomic and subatomic level, where the classical physics that explain matter and energy and their behavior as seen on a typical everyday human scale, seem to completely break. A lot of the concepts and observations of quantum mechanics are very counterintuitive, bizarre, and perplexing, such as the fact that at this scale, the result of an experiment can be different depending on whether it is being observed or not. And while that, yes, does make my hair stand on end, it in no way makes it a fact that everything is connected or explain love and connection, whatever that means. And the assertion that anything from quantum mechanics can actually be applied to clinical practice of psychology is so ridiculous, considering that we barely even have the flimsiest proposed explanations for even the most rudimentary observations made in quantum physics. But I guess at least he doesn't seem to be anti-vax, because that's how low the bar is now. John Rallis, a chiropractor, says that Ina's brilliant insights and compelling case histories challenge all of us to transcend our preconceptions and personal limitations, which is a really dumb thing to say, because you shouldn't be basing your clinical practice or your overall understanding of a condition on a case study, because that's all a case study is. It is a story about one case. It is so wild that I have to explain that, well, this is what happened once, is neither compelling nor evidence. The fact that it's a case study in the first place suggests that the case was notable and rare enough that it was worth writing a case study about. Case studies in medical literature are basically like, they're either an FYI or they're the equivalent of a post to r/mildly interesting. You're not supposed to fundamentally change your approach to patient care and standards of practice based on a case study. Like, if I came back from West Wendover, Nevada and told you I won $100 at the slot machines, are you going to jump in the car and go bet your life savings? No? How come? Don't you believe me? That's an important point, actually. We have multiple issues here. The first issue is we have no idea if what is described in that case report ever actually took place, and if so, were all the relevant details included? The second issue is that even if it is true, the fact that something happened once doesn't mean it is remotely likely to happen again. Weird things happen all the time. All the time. Happen all the time. The third and final issue is that in the case studies in this book, there's always an assumption of causality, that the condition improved because of the treatment, which is bullshit, because it probably would have improved anyway. But I guess we'll never know, since you had a literal sample size of one and no control group. I looked at Con Rallis's chiropractic office's Facebook page, because I guess they can't afford a Squarespace subscription. And this post here, I have to share because it is amazing. So it says in the caption, "Wise words by the good Dr. Thomas Alva Edison," which I already object to, because Thomas Edison was not a doctor and he was also not good. He was an arrogant prick and a colossal jackass. But let's continue. Can I just say, chiropractors are obsessed with this quote. You would almost think they were legally required to post it everywhere. I guarantee you we'll find it on any chiropractor's social media pages or website, or at least in one location in the office. Quote, "The doctor of the future will give no medicine, but will interest his patient in the care of the human frame, in diet, and in the cause and prevention of disease." Thomas Jefferson? What? Wrong Thomas. Thomas Jefferson died 21 years before Thomas Edison was even born. It's definitely a real Thomas Edison quote, though. And while I reject the implied premise that Edison should be regarded as some sort of authority on medical practice, I feel it is very important to point out that chiropractors never, ever provide the context of this quote or the sentences around it. The quote is from 1903, and the full context is, quote, "1903 will bring great advances in surgery, in the study of bacteria, and in the knowledge of the cause and prevention of disease. Medicine is played out. Every new discovery of bacteria shows us all the more convincingly that we have been wrong and that the million tons of stuff we have taken was all useless. The doctor of the future will give no medicine, but will instruct his patient in the care of the human frame, in diet, and in the cause and prevention of disease. They may even discover the germ of old age. I don't predict it, But it might be by the sacrifice of animal life, human life could be prolonged. Yeah, see, he's a douchebag. Surgery, diet, antiseptics. These three are the vital things of the future in preserving the health of humanity. There were never so many able, active minds at work on the problems of diseases as now, and all their discoveries are tending to the simple truth. You can't improve upon nature. It is extremely important to remember that this quote is from 1903. There were very few safe and effective drugs in 1903. Nearly everything being marketed as a drug was either some snake oil patent medicine cure-all concoction or a cocktail of morphine, cocaine, and alcohol. What Edison is talking about when he says medicine and drug were a completely different thing. He even points out that the newly discovered bacteria aren't affected by the tinctures and miracle powders and snake oil remedies of the day. Even aspirin, which is widely considered to be the first truly safe and effective modern pharmaceutical, had only gone into production at Bayer in 1899, and incredibly, when World War I caused major supply chain issues for the production of aspirin for the notably German company due to a lack of phenol, they were able to procure a supply from the neutral United States. At the time, a phonograph record manufacturer had been experiencing the same issues with shortages of phenol, which they used in producing the coating on the discs, and to remedy that issue, had built their own plant to synthesize the chemical and happened to have excess product available. And the owner of that phonograph record company was Mr. Thomas Edison. Edison's company supplied Bayer with enough phenol to last beyond the end of World War I in what would later be exposed as the Great Phenol Plot of 1915, which was not illegal in the US because the US was neutral, but it did provoke widespread public outrage when it hit the newspapers. Go figure. All right, next endorsement. A great set of insights into how to stay healthy and well, says 9/11 truther Tom Hartman. Next. Ina Segal's advice and techniques are spot on when it comes to effectiveness. As a practitioner with many years' experience in healing therapies, I can vouch for the accuracy and practicality of Ina's recommendations. I recommend you buy this book. It is set to become a classic in the field of mind-body medicine, says acupuncture quack and hypnotist Dr. Ralph Ballard, who was reprimanded in 2011 for prescribing potentially harmful intravenous ozone gas therapy to a man who would die of brain cancer 18 days later with no other check-ins from Ballard beforehand instead of, you know, sending the patient to palliative care. Next. With her book, The Secret Language of Your Body, Ina Segal has made a significant contribution to the growing body of knowledge in the field of mind, body, spirit. Her work encompasses the underlying mental and emotional causes of malfunction in all parts of the body, with additional insights into the emotions and the use of color in healing. Importantly, her book focuses on what people can do for themselves rather than what healthcare professionals can do for them, says Peter Johnston, who resigned from his medical practice in 2021 because he refused to vaccinate children for COVID-19. The central thesis of this book is basically that disease has primarily emotional, mental, and energetic causes, as in diseases caused by various emotions. I really cannot begin to express to you how deeply and profoundly stupid this book is. So what I'm going to have to do is read you some of the most incredible passages in it to provide examples of how the premise doesn't work and also just to share the absolute absurdity of this book. It's broken into three huge chapters. The first chapter is organized by body part, with each body part then having emotions listed that can cause problems with it. And then it gives a weird woo-woo treatment to do to supposedly heal the problem. Oh, what problem? Yeah, the book is really vague and sprawling like that. The entire time, it's almost more like word association than coherent sentences. The second chapter is organized by disease, although a lot of the things that it lists are not really diseases, but they're kind of just vague concepts. with each disease having a list of emotions that can supposedly cause it. Although, once again, the book is kind of fuzzy with its structure because some of the conditions appear to have more of a list of symptoms than a list of causes. It's really vague and fluffy and annoying. And the third chapter is a bunch of like woo-woo treatments, which are like little like meditations or like colors that you're supposed to use. It's super weird. So let's get into it. Yeah, so I have my printed copy here because all together now I print things out like an old man. Okay, get over it. Let's start off with a relatively tame one. So the abdomen. Ready? Possible contributing factors. Difficulty digesting life, propensity to hold on to toxic feelings, thoughts, and hurts from the past. Constant fear and worry about the future, which creates struggle and suffering in the present. Frequent feelings of insecurity and confusion about what to do and what choices to make. Deep-seated belief of not being good enough. Fear of rejection and failure. Wanting to be the center of attention, but being afraid of being judged. Like, what? And so, you know, here's the remedy. Take a deep breath in through your nose and slowly breathe out from your mouth. Relax and soften your abdomen as much as possible. If you experience pain in your abdomen, imagine that you have a vacuum cleaner in your hands. Visualize vacuuming all the density, toxicity, and pain out of your abdomen. Say, divine healing intelligence, I ask you to release all toxic thoughts and feelings, old painful experiences, stuckness, struggle, and rejection out of my abdomen, as well as all points of view, all patterns, and the positive and negative charges that contribute to this condition. Repeat the word clear until you feel a shift occur. Rub your hands together until they become warm and tingly, then place your hands on your abdomen. Say, divine healing intelligence, please install feelings and experiences of ease, relaxation, and freedom. I now invite healing, loving, and empowering energy into my life. Thank you. Allow your body to take in the energy of wellness from your divine healing intelligence and your hands. Now imagine how it would feel to be completely healthy, confident, and secure. How would you think? How would you feel? What would your life experience be like? What would your posture be like? How would others respond to you? Allow yourself to see it, feel it, and experience it. When you have done this, go outside and find a stone, hold that stone, and repeat the previous visualization process. In which you saw yourself becoming healthier and more confident. This time, make the process even stronger. Carry this stone with you for the next month. Squeeze it anytime you need extra confidence or a boost of healing energy. You gotta carry a stone for a month, you guys. Say, divine healing intelligence, please heal and regenerate my abdomen and all related organs to their full health and vitality. Thank you. Oh, okay. And so here's your unhealthy emotions to work with. Those would be fear, frustration, and rejection. And for healthy emotions you want to work with, peace, relaxation, and freedom. Yeah. Colors to work with, yellow and orange. It's like, what? You have to carry a stone? Why? Oof. Oh boy. Yeah, and it's all like this. It's all it, like this, all of it's of this shit. But don't worry, it gets better. Here's one that's going to set a theme for something that she does in this book a lot. Bladder. Feeling timid, wishy-washy, inefficient, annoyed, irritable, sad, and guilty. Okay. First of all, like, that was a lot. That was a very... this is always how woo-woo practitioners are, too. It's like, they Like, that was a very big list of emotions. You're really making a big target, aren't you? I mean, shit. Has anyone never experienced anything on that list? That was a pretty huge list. You're not really, shotgunning this, huh? Sense of powerlessness and frustration, feeling angry or pissed off. Okay, this pissed off thing, she really, really loves this wordplay with the pissed off. Pissed off appears anytime there's anything that you could piss out of. She's always like, oh, you're pissed off, that's why. And I'm like, how do you know that it's pissed off? But and furthermore, like, I don't think any other language, at least like that I know of, I'm sure there are other languages that use a like pissed something to mean angry. That I feel like that's not that common. For example, if you're saying someone pisses you off in Spanish, it's usually hinchar las pelotas or tocar las pelotas or like tocar los huevos. It's like it gets on my balls. Or I think in Spain you can get up someone's nose. Does this just mean for English speakers the bladder means you're pissed off, means you're angry? I don't understand. It's just weird. The pissed off thing, it is used throughout this book. Anytime anything related to urination comes up, it's, oh, it's because you're pissed off. I don't know. It just seems so obvious to me that clearly that's an idiomatic expression and it's not going to be universally able to be literally translated. And it's a common theme, like she'll use several idiomatic expressions to then make the link to the emotion from the body part that exhibits it. It's really dumb. Like it's really surface level. It almost reminds me of it's kind of an almost evangelical way of thinking where it's like if it's wordplay, then it's true. If there's a pun, then it's true. Or if it's catchy, then it's true. Yeah, I don't know. Feeling angry or pissed off with a partner or person you are close to, wanting to be somewhere else rather than where you are. Holding on to worries from the past which stop you from moving forward. Lack of boundaries, needing your own space. Ready for the remedy? Inhale deeply several times. Place your hands on your How can you place your hands on your bladder? Place your hands on your bladder and tune into what you are feeling. Are you angry, pissed off, or irritated with someone or something in your life? Are you allowing this irritation to control your life? Say, divine healing intelligence, I ask you to dissolve all feelings of anger, indecisiveness, weakness, irritability, powerlessness, and worry from my bladder. As well as all points of view, all patterns, and the positive and negative charges that contribute to this condition. Repeat the word clear until you feel a shift occur. Rub your hands together. Place your palms slightly apart, feeling the tingling sensation. Imagine that you hold in your hands a yellow ball of healing energy. Of course it's yellow. Ask the divine healing intelligence to make this ball of energy stronger. You may even see or sense rays of golden sunlight energizing this ball, making it more powerful and effective. Place your hands on your bladder, allowing the ball to penetrate deeply into your bladder. Ew. Ah. No. Focus on the warmth emanating from this golden ball as it dissolves and purifies the physical, emotional, and mental density and tension in the bladder. Observe it until the bladder comes back into perfect health and vitality. Say, divine healing intelligence, please install feelings and experiences of confidence, certainty, determination, harmony, happiness, humor, and joy.
You sure you just don't want a Coke?
Thank you. To make the process even more powerful, gently hum the vowel sound ooh and direct the sound toward the bladder. You're like, ooh. Allow the sound to infuse your bladder with healing and balancing energy. Hum for a minute or two. Divine healing intelligence, please heal and regenerate my bladder and all related organs to their maximum strength, vitality, and well-being. Thank you. But feelings of distrust, disappointment, lack of self-esteem, and possibilities. Fear, ignorance, and loss of power. Lack of stability and security. Holding on to stress, old stubborn anger, and guilt. Loss of sexual energy or feeling unattractive. Feeling stuck and fearful of new experiences. Your own wisdom, your innate ability to create. Many people walk all day with very tight buttocks. Holding on to stress, fear, and tension. Consciously focus on relaxing your buttocks. You can do this by slowly breathing in and tightening your buttocks while you hold your breath for 5 seconds. Then relax your buttocks as you slowly breathe out. Repeat the process 8 to 10 times. Careful with that. Then gently massage the buttocks or shake them out until they feel more relaxed. Check regularly to see if they are tight or relaxed and do this exercise anytime there is tension. Say, divine healing intelligence, I ask you to melt all resentment, sexual tension, distress, disappointment, lack, fear, ignorance, anger, guilt, or loss of power out of my buttocks, as well as all points of view, all patterns, and the positive and negative charges that contribute to this condition. Repeat the word clear until you feel a shift occur. Every day for a week, look at your behind in the mirror and compliment it. Find all the things you like about it. Say to yourself, I love my buttocks. Saying this will allow your lower back and hips to relax more, relieve tension, and ease any pain and difficulty in walking. Say, divine healing intelligence, please install a sense of stability, innocence, and enjoyment of my sensuality. Allow me to experience fun, playfulness, and pleasure. Thank you. Say, divine healing intelligence, please heal and regenerate my butt and all related organs to their maximum health, vitality, and well-being. Thank you. What the f... It's so weird. It's so weird. But it gets worse. Anus. Difficulty letting go of outdated family beliefs and fears. Feeling guilty, regretful, and uncomfortable with decisions that were made in the past. Holding on to anger toward yourself and others. Fear of loss and abandonment. Inability to forgive and learn from the past. Constant criticism of self and others. Feeling unhappy with yourself and your life. Feeling like no matter what you do, it's never enough. Trying to control life. Feeling betrayed that what you thought was true may not be. Believing that you are not worthy of good things in life. How many things are you going to list? Remedy. Ready for this? Place your attention on your anus. Inhale and exhale deeply. Allow the breath to move through your entire body. Focus on the process of letting go. When you pay for something, you let go of your money but receive something in return. When you move to another home, you let go of the old to welcome the new. When you let go of pain, you welcome well-being into your life. Slowly take a deep breath in and gently squeeze the muscles of your anus. When you exhale, relax them. As you squeeze, focus on the negative feeling or belief you are holding on to. When you relax, focus on letting them go. I can't. It's so stupid. Say, divine healing intelligence, I ask you to release all guilt, blame, criticism, anger, outdated fears, and stuckness out of my anus, and as well as all points of view, all patterns, and the positive and negative charges from that contribute to positive and negative charges that contribute to this condition. Repeat the word clear until you feel a shift occur. Rub your hands together. Place them slightly apart. Focus on the tingling sensation. Visualize orange light between your hands. Place your hands on your anus. Breathe in the orange rays and allow them to clear all the toxicity out of your anus. You may feel internal tingling and adjustment. Keep breathing for a minute as this occurs. Say, divine healing intelligence, please install feelings and experiences of wisdom, faith, and self-confidence. Thank you. Give yourself permission to move forward and make empowering decisions that can bring happiness and well-being into your life. Say, divine healing intelligence, please heal and regenerate my anus and all related organs to their full health and vitality. Thank you. You know, I feel bad for the divine healing intelligence that it has to hear all this from you. At least God doesn't usually, I don't think, have to listen to this shit. I don't see any of this being effective. I see it all being pretty weird, pretty awkward. It's basically a horoscope, right? It's a horoscope. It's throwing out a ton of things that are actually quite vague. They kind of seem like they could be specific, but they're not. It's not specific to just say, oh, you experience fear. Everyone experiences fear. Some of these are super ridiculous. For toes, not only is it different for the right foot and left foot, but it also has to go, like, it has a different thing for right big toe, right second toe, right third toe, right fourth toe, right little toe. And they're all different lists of emotion. If you're big toe, it's you're confused in your direction in life. You're asking yourself, where am I going? You're feeling stuck, fearful of moving forward. Here's the other thing. A lot of these things sound the same. The feeling stuck, that is in a ton of these. Because there's only so many things you can feel, all right? And especially when you're listing like 20 million things in each one. Each one has such a long list, okay? That's the right big toe. Right second toe, worries and feelings of inferiority and insecurity, which again is similar, but like difficulty belonging to a group or cause, judging yourself and others, watching your step, feeling second best, not knowing who to trust or listen to. It's so vague and just huge and annoying. Right third toe. Experiencing a lack of clarity about a situation. Difficulty seeing the future, especially in relation to your work or financial situation. Unrealistic expectations. Feeling like a failure or struggling to step forward. Right fourth toe. Feelings of tiredness, confusion, anxiety, and depression, like a small child who wants to hide from life. Right little toe, suppressed aggression, belief that life is a struggle and that you have to work hard, whatever. Okay, left big toe, feeling overwhelmed and confused about choices made as if there is a blurry line between what you think is right and wrong. Left second toe, confused about people and their motivations, uncertain of the direction you need to move in, afraid to initiate change. Left third toe, feeling suppression, shame, anger, low self-worth, limitation, lack of choices, focusing too much on past regrets and what you could have done differently. Left fourth toe, feeling out of control and misunderstood. These are all like the same thing. Left little toe, feeling unappreciated and neglected, self-criticizing, feeling like a child who cannot please his or her angry parent, belief that you can never do anything right. What the fuck? What is this base? Where are you getting all of this? I don't understand. It's so batshit crazy. It's so horoscopy. I understand the appeal of wanting a solution to things and to have that solution be having been always within you all along. But I mean, that doesn't make it true just because you want it to be. I just feel like this is so obviously just throwing spaghetti at the wall and seeing what sticks. There are so many feelings listed in each one, and they're actually all pretty vague feelings. It's not like, oh, well, you know, it's because you're mad about that one thing that's happening at work or whatever. No, it's like fear. Okay. Uncertainty about the future. Everyone has uncertainty about the future. That's not like a unique thing.
So now that you've gotten a taste for what it's like for the body part organized section, we're going to go to the diseases. At the beginning of this chapter, she points out that she's listed examples of emotions, but not every dense or destructive feeling or thought I listed will relate to you. So, you know, it might be right or wrong somehow. And lest anyone think that she's just, that she's not saying that it causes it. Oh, yeah, she is. She's saying that these emotions cause these disorders. So, because she says right here, often just recognizing the thoughts, emotions, and attitudes that have contributed to the problem can initiate the healing process. This is because when you have an awareness of the cause of the issue, you have choice. Choice gives you an opportunity to reflect on your life, become aware of what does not work, and do something different. So, I would say that that means these are the causes.
And this is where it gets extremely, extremely offensive. So, I mean, sorry, it's going to sound really, really judgy because that's the way it is. But first, she gives a case. Zelda came to me because she had problems with her heart and wanted to find out what was the cause of her pain. When we looked at what was happening in Zelda's life, she began to see patterns emerging. Zelda held on to buried pain from the past. She was constantly stressed about her work, and she was worried about people in her life. She lived alone and felt isolated and lonely. She was also extremely self-critical of any little mistakes she made. Well, I mean, that's because she's trapped in, you know, and she's waiting for Link to come get her. Once Zelda truly became aware, I was not ready for that. Not ready for that adverb to come first. Once Zelda truly became aware of what she was doing to herself and how it was causing her heart disease, see what I mean? She began forgiving the people who had hurt her in the past, letting go of her buried pain. You never are required to forgive anybody, okay? You should forgive them if they give you a reason to forgive them, okay? Zelda realized that her job was causing her a lot of unhappiness, and she quit. Well, maybe if your job's making you unhappy, you should just quit. Wow, that's great advice. That's great advice. Yeah, that's totally an option for most people. She also began to socialize more, relax, and do creative things that opened her heart. Well, I mean, that doesn't sound healthy for her heart. I mean, now she's gonna have to go to the hospital. Rather than being so harsh with herself, she started using humor, laughing instead of beating herself up. Incredibly, her heart condition, which doctors said was incurable, healed. I don't doubt that a heart condition can be... The risk of a heart condition can certainly be caused by stress and all that kind of thing going on. Because, I mean, that's... It's going to like raise your heart rate. It's going to raise your blood pressure, all that shit. She never says what the heart condition actually was. It just says problems with her heart. That could be anything. That could be like heart block. That could be high blood pressure. That could be heart failure. We don't know. And which doctors had said was incurable. We don't know what it is. Was it high blood pressure? Because yeah, I mean, that's like incurable, but you can improve it, you know? Things spontaneously get better all the time. That's not unheard of. Just because something spontaneously gets better doesn't mean that you can start telling patients that it is curable. Because curable means as a routine thing, this thing is curable, which it's not. And that's why they have to say that it's incurable. So don't say that these doctors are so wrong and they're just so stupid. No, you can't say that something is curable. If something's curable, that means that 95, 99% of the time you can cure it. Jesus. So we don't know what her heart condition was. We don't know what exactly it was that her doctors told her. We don't know if this is even a real person. We don't know if it actually We don't know if it actually healed. Based on what? Based on what tests? How do you know that it got better? How do you know that Zelda doesn't just feel like it's gotten better because she stopped going to the doctor? How do we know that? We don't know. How do we know that any of this is true? And even if it is true, that's okay. That this story is just, this is what happened once. Well, that's not convincing. And it's really irresponsible to be telling stories like this with the intent of getting people to stop going to their doctor. Here's another one. Ruth was the same way. Although she was unable to see me in person, she lived in a different city, we decided to organize a distance healing session. I learned that Ruth had a tumor growing on her pituitary gland, which was causing high levels of prolactin to enter her bloodstream. On the physical level, Ruth was experiencing severe headaches and visual problems. Although doctors recommended that she start taking heavy medication, she decided to try the natural approach. Yeah, thanks to fucking flimflammers like you. I was able to share with Ruth the reasons for her tumor. No, you fucking weren't. And she was astounded at how accurately I read what was happening in her life. That's because you throw a bunch of vague ass shit that applies to everybody. You throw a bunch of spaghetti at the wall and see what sticks. And people only notice the noodles that stick. And then you latch onto those and you keep going. It's called cold reading, Ina. Jesus. I recommended that she work with some of the exercises in this book, and after about 6 months, I received a letter from her telling me how thrilled she was with her results. She told me that a few days after the healing treatment, her head felt much clearer, and she has not suffered one migraine since. Ruth also went to the doctor for her yearly checkup. The doctor was astonished, just astonished, that the prolactin levels in her blood had reduced to near normal, a phenomenon he could not explain. Yeah, he could. Ruth felt that she had enormous proof of the power in her own self-healing ability. She didn't have proof of the power in her own self-healing ability. Spontaneous remission is common enough that there's a term for it, that there's a term, spontaneous remission. It happens. It happens all the time. All the time. Happens all the time. Furthermore, again, we don't know what could be causing the prolactin levels to come down. How do we know that the tumor was reduced? Furthermore, how do we know Ruth is real? How do we know that what Ruth is telling us is accurate? How do you know that it's accurate? How do we know what you're telling us is accurate? We don't. And even if all of that is accurate, again, this is just what happened once, and we don't know that the self-healing caused that. Spontaneous remission is a thing, and we don't know if remission is even what occurred. All we know is that supposedly the doctor was astonished and couldn't explain why the prolactin levels were low. Which, yeah, you could. It's called spontaneous remission. That's what it's called. If that's what really happened. Did we get another scan or something to see if the tumor has gone away or has reduced? Besides, you also said near normal. What does near normal mean? How far above normal was it? What is that? What is near normal? This is so fucking irresponsible, because when you say this shit and you're like, oh, well, the doctors couldn't do anything. Someone's going to read this and they're going to do this instead of going to the doctor for a fucking tumor. And you're going to have blood on your hands. This is so irresponsible. I have traveled to many countries to teach my work and have received feedback from all over the world. A healthcare professional from Pakistan emailed me that he taught some processes from this book to 20 of his clients who had either high blood pressure or diabetes. Within 3 weeks, all the participants had reported that they had no more pain in their body, were no longer tired, and felt energetic. They did not feel thirsty or need to use the restroom as frequently. Among those who were helped by the process, 9 were on insulin and no longer required it. Does she think that you can feel high blood pressure? Because you can't. You have no idea if your blood pressure is high or whatever. And the only way to know that is to check their blood pressure. And notice that she didn't say anything about their blood pressure normalizing, because it was either high blood pressure or diabetes. And polydipsia is not how we diagnose diabetes, or how we classify it, at least. It might be why you suspect it, as in like excessive thirst is polydipsia. Did we check blood sugar levels? Did they do anything else while they were doing these healing exercises? Furthermore, again, I don't know what happened in Pakistan, ma'am, and who is this doctor? What's his name? We don't know. So stupid. It's so stupid and irresponsible. Diabetes untreated is deadly. It is not something that just goes away. Diabetes doesn't do that. It can get better or worse. If it's type 2 diabetes, it can get like better and worse. But it does not just go away. And it absolutely does not go away for type 1, because you can't regenerate the beta cells of the pancreas once they're destroyed. Like, that doesn't happen. So stop. I get the feeling that when Rachel Hollis is talking about this book, it's like it's kind of like, you know, horoscopes are for some people, where it's like, oh, you know, it's fun. Like, I don't really think it's real, but like, it's kind of fun to see the patterns emerge or whatever, to, you know, make the little links and stuff, because our brain likes, you know, pattern confirmations. That's whatever. That's fine if you want to do that. But when you're talking about this shit, you're talking about very serious things. And even if you start off with this shit and you aren't, you know, an anti-vaxxer or whatever at that point, when you are around the people in this community, you are going to hear them talk about that bullshit all the time. And when you are around, when you're constantly surrounding yourself with people, you're going to start to think the way that they think. It's very difficult to resist something that you're hearing all the time from the people around you that you trust, apparently. You know, and soon enough, you're believing all kinds of conspiracy theories. I mean, look at how many of the people endorsing this book were anti-vaxxers and conspiracy theorists. That's alarming. That's not a normal sample, okay? That's not good. And shame on Rachel Hollis for promoting this garbage. It is garbage. So, let's look at some diseases and find out the real causes. This ancient wisdom bullshit it's such trash. I mean, you don't even have to think about it that hard to realize that it's bullshit. Okay, if there's some ancient wisdom that's been lost, you know, that there was there and now we've lost it, why do we live longer than people in ancient times did? Why didn't they live longer than us? Because they objectively lived shorter, harder, more painful lives than we currently do. Why? If they had so much wisdom, if they were so much smarter than us, why were their lives so short and difficult? And why was there so much more infant mortality than there is now? Why was there so much more disease? Okay, because it's not like, oh, well, they never got vaccinated and they were fine. Nuh-uh. No, they died. That's what happened. I mean, and maybe there's, maybe when you read sources from back then, you don't see quite as much, you know, as much discussion of it as you might expect, because that's just the way it was then. It was just, that's just the way it was. If you got this disease, you died. And that was there to them, like there was no other way, because they just knew that when you get this disease, you die. It's so frustrating because it's just people want to believe what they want to believe. And there's really no point arguing with these people half the time. But what you can do is stop someone from sliding into this garbage. So a common theme in these is I found that anger, frustration, irritation is in like half of the list of emotions, which is weird. You know, could it cause all of them or? Content warning here. There could be something in here that is triggering for you. I would check the description. I am going to have a chapter marker to skip each disease. And I will also be calling out a couple that could be especially triggering. As we go along. Thanks. So let's find out for each of these diseases what you did to cause it for yourself, because it's always your fault. And that's where I was so surprised looking at this, because I expected it to be bullshit, but I didn't expect it to be so mean. AIDS. Feeling guilty, wronged, disappointed, dirty. Sexual shame. Belief in inequality, injustice, and inferiority. Yeah, who believes in that? You're just, it's all in your head. I mean, snap out of it. Feeling defeated and not good enough, important or worthy. Rejection of the self, experiencing inner turmoil, struggle, and weakness. Like, what? Okay, I think some of these feelings that you're listing here are more of things that were caused by AIDS. Also, it's weird that she just says like AIDS, like, okay. So we're just going right to the end stage, I guess. Well, I guess because if they're following your practices, they wouldn't go to the doctor. So they probably don't know that they have it until it progresses into AIDS, huh? Like, what the fuck? There's nothing in here about, you know, unprotected sex or IV drug use or anything. If I were listing the causes, I might mention that. But no, it's obviously because you believe in inequality and injustice. Who believes in that? It's not real. So stupid. Oh, so here's a good one for summer. Ready? Allergies. Feeling annoyed and aggravated by other people. Giving away your power. Blaming people and events for your negative reactions.
Yeah.
Obsession with people who have hurt you. Yeah, like, stop. Why are you so obsessed with them? Difficulty forgiving and seeing the blessing in this hurt. Allowing yourself to be controlled or manipulated by others and then punishing them by withholding love and kindness. Not knowing how to create boundaries with others. What the fuck? So, yeah. So if you have been controlled or manipulated by others, that's your fault. Obviously, you're allowing them to do it. Okay. Like, it's like, why are you allowing them to control and manipulate you? Stop doing that. Stop letting them control and manipulate you. And after they control and manipulate you, why are you being so rude, unloving, and unkind? You should be nice to people who control and manipulate you. It's really like, why are you being such a douche? You're too pretty to not be smiling. You got to see the blessing in this hurt. It's a blessing, y'all. I'm always like, I wish someone would control, manipulate, and hurt me. Then I would be so blessed. It'd be great. Love it. Instead, I'm just having healthy relationships and stupid shit like that. Don't even message me on Grindr if you're not manipulative. Okay, asthma. Here's what you're doing to cause your asthma. Trying too hard to please others. Wanting to be perfect, difficulty saying no, standing up for yourself and expressing how you feel, pushing yourself to the limit until you feel exhausted and out of breath, feeling weak, anxious, and disempowered, allowing others to control you, feeling hurt, stuck, and caged. What the, like, how many things are you gonna list? Like, which, I find it, and she even said, remember, that not all of the things that she lists are going to apply to you, okay? So who's not going to at least be able to, like, pick out one of those things that applies? It's so stupid. But at least now, you know, you won't need that Advair prescription because you're going to cure your asthma. That's how it works. Okay, yeah, so she says, like, physical ailments in here. There's literally an entry for belching. I think that's probably from eating too quickly or, you know, drinking too much soda or something, but I mean, that's just me. Sure. Content warning, we are about to get into a section where the author is going to explain birth defects. It is not just a mention. This author is extremely mean and judgmental. If that's something that you're not prepared to handle, please skip to the time on the screen, or you can click the chapter marker. Birth defects. I'm just going to remind you that if I read something, I'm about to read a statement that is very judgy and very victim-blamey. Birth defects. Karmic decision to come into this life to learn lessons of humility and love. Carrying intense stress and anxiety from the womb in relation to parents. Karmic decision to come into this life to learn lessons of humility and love. Who would decide that? Karmic decision to come into this life to learn lessons of humility and love. That's why you have a birth defect. That is like one of the most offensive things I've ever read. So if you have a birth defect, it's your fault and your parents' fault. Because... ridiculous. Absolutely offensive. Absolutely unacceptable. Bladder cancer. Uncomfortable with what you are feeling or doing in your life. Guilt about past or present actions. Internal conflict. A need for boundaries in your own space. I thought you said that if they don't have boundaries, that's going to cause other things. Jesus. Feeling angry or pissed off. See, once again, that's what I was talking about. She loves riffing off of pissed off. Does it every time. Feeling angry or pissed off with a person close to you, but burying these feelings instead of expressing them. A deep sense of unresolved sadness. So if you have bladder cancer, that's why. Because you're pissed off, see? Like, what is this? The Middle Ages? Like, what are you fucking... And it's like a person close to you. Could you be more specific? You know, it's like when Kimberly on that on the podcast episode was like, oh, it's someone close to me. It's a female. And it's like, what is this? 20 questions? Why doesn't it just drop the name for you? Like, what the fuck? Like, why do you have to do so much guessing? This doesn't seem like it's giving you very good information. Kind of seems like it's not very quality. I don't know. If you got to play 20 questions with it. Here's an interesting one. Boils. Like, you know, like blisters or whatever. Blood boiling anger that has been carefully controlled. That is an idiomatic expression. Okay? Because there's a couple problems with it. Number one, I'm sure not every language says making my blood boil for making me angry. I know a lot of languages definitely do, but not all of them. And I don't know of a single other language. I checked. There might be some, but I don't know of another language that uses the same word for like blister as they use for water in a phase change. Like, I don't know of any language where like you can have a boil and like water can boil and it's the same word. So like what? Does this only apply to English speakers or what? Is that how this works? That's so weird. Is English the official language of... Is that the secret language of your body? It's English? Okay. Is it that for everybody? Okay. You know, because if there's wordplay, it's true. Oh, here's another one. Burnout. Overcommitting and pushing yourself too hard, not knowing when to stop, perfectionism, resisting different points of view, forcing things to happen, difficulty saying no, putting others' needs before your own, stubbornness, refusing to listen to your body and recognize your own value, an attitude that is never enough. See also, burns. Are we doing this again where like we're relying on English idiomatic expressions? Because like I doubt it's burnout in other languages where burnout and burn are the same word. Because then for burns, she says feeling burned out or tired. If it's wordplay, it's true. It's I think you got a burn because you touched something that was too hot. So stupid. Another thing that annoys me is it'll be like, it'll say things that are related to a disease, but the thing itself is not a disease. It says here, cholesterol. What do you mean? High cholesterol? What do you mean cholesterol? Oh, here's another really vague heading. Chronic illness. Girl, what do you mean? Can you please be more specific? Chronic, what do you... Half of the things you've already listed are chronic illness. So which thing are they supposed to follow? Are they supposed to follow the more specific one? Oh, unless that one's not accurate, then you want them to follow this one and make sure it's right. Right. Okay. Got it. Deafness. Not liking what you're hearing. They're deaf.
Overwhelmed by the negativity, blocking your ears, constantly saying or thinking, I don't want to hear it. Do you understand what deafness is? Feeling rejected or rejecting others. Feeling like a victim. Thinking that what you say or communicate is not important, that people don't want to hear you. Being stubborn, inflexible, or controlling. See also, earache. What? And it kind of seems like you don't really know what deafness means. But anyway, that's why people are deaf, is it's their fault. They're being too controlling, okay? And, you know, they're always just playing the victim card. Here's another weird heading. Dreams. Okay, I thought this was a list of physical ailments. That's pretty sure dreams are normal. I mean, although... I don't know if this is weird or not, but I have never in 32 years, I have never had a good dream. I only have nightmares. I don't know what that says about me, but I mean, maybe I've had a good dream that I don't remember, but I've never had one that I've remembered. I only have nightmares. Repressed thoughts, ideas, and experiences enabling you to receive insights, visions, ideas, new perspectives, and solutions to unresolved issues. Often predictive, problem solving, creative, and releasing. So stupid. Infertility. Fear of losing your freedom. Not feeling supported. Unsure if you will make a good parent. Limited ideas about parenthood. Unresolved issues from your childhood. Blocking the process by being desperate to conceive. Feeling angry, resentful, and hurt that you can't. Or fearful that you may not be able to. Feeling jealous and irritated that other people have children and you don't. Self-criticism, lack of fun, not trusting life, not allowing yourself to enjoy your connections with children. So you see, it's kind of like dating. If you want it really badly, then you can't have it, okay? Like, because then you look desperate and you don't want to look desperate. You know, you have to not want children very much, and then you can have them. Children only come to those who don't want them. I mean, it's all your fault. Flatulence, holding back, feeling uncomfortable, inability to express your emotions clearly, resistant to change. And then there's another interesting entry in here. It just says heart blockage, which I don't know if it means that's not a thing. Heart blockage is not a thing. I feel like maybe it's supposed to be heart block. Heart block is not a blockage in the blood flow. Heart block is an interruption in the electrical signal conduction in the heart, where you will have it not getting from the atria to the ventricles, and that causes an arrhythmia. But again, it's probably something that to see your doctor about rather than doing this fucking book. I'm just gonna go out on a limb here. Hiccups. Difficulty expressing your true feelings to people. Deep desire to please others and a need to rebel and do your own thing. So, okay, so like maybe you're this thing, but like maybe you're the opposite. Oh, okay. Well, thanks for being clear about it. Impotence. Feeling angry, pissed off, once again, rejected. See, this is one where I feel like if you took that off of the phrase pissed off and then used like the UK definition, if you just said pissed all the time, getting pissed all the time, going on the piss, that would be more accurate. I feel like if it's one or the other, it's probably going on the piss all the time. You know, it provokes desire, but it takes away the performance. Perhaps you booze in too much. And then there's an entry in here for insanity, which that's not a medical term. That's not a medical thing. That's insanity is a legal term. So I don't know why that's in here. It says under itching, which again, like, that's a symptom. It's not really a whatever. It says not liking what you are doing or where you are, itching to get away. I feel like that's an idiomatic expression. I don't know. Do other languages use itching like that? Can't help but notice that there are entries in here for measles and the mumps. Although, you know, you might want to put the rubella in here as well, since, you know, if enough people are listening to your preaching and the disinformation provided by your little community, they'll be at risk for that one too, because I'm assuming they're not getting their MMR vaccine, you know, because we would have eradicated the measles already, but we haven't yet. So honestly, I'm surprised we were able to eliminate smallpox. Fun fact, did you know that the word vaccine comes from the fact that the smallpox vaccine was developed from cowpox, and in Spanish, vaca is cow. So like, that's the Latin root of it, is VAC. So you get vaccine. But, you know, I guess if they had just known what emotions were causing smallpox, then they wouldn't have needed to get a vaccine made from cowpox. Swelling. Carrying negative beliefs and feelings that fester in your body and block your health and success. Suppressing old grief and pain, allowing it to grow until your body swells. Carrying frozen tears that need to melt and come out. What? What are you talking about? Like, what are you talking about?
Content warning here. We are about to get to the section where she discusses miscarriage. It is very mean and very judgmental. So if that's something that is going to be triggering for you, please skip ahead to 1 hour 24 minutes and 4 seconds, or click the chapter marker in the description.
Miscarriage. Not ready for children. Fear of childbirth and responsibility. Unresolved family issues. A need of being soft, gentle, and loving with yourself. It is possible the soul of the fetus is not ready to be born, or the body is defective and too weak to survive. How you can write that for someone who has had a miscarriage to read is beyond me. That is utterly sociopathic. That is utterly heinous. Utterly heinous. What a thing to say. It's because you're not ready, or the soul of the fetus didn't. I don't understand. I don't understand how you could write that and feel like you just wrote something that is fine. Unbelievable. I mean, it's really, really unbelievable. You should be ashamed of yourself. Everything is just, it's your fault. So I think that gives enough of a showing of how utterly disgusting, irresponsible, utterly reckless and flat out just mean and honestly kind of abusive this book is, it's really a dangerous book in my opinion. And even if you start off having pretty normal, a normal grip on reality and how to evaluate facts, I really think that it's going to be very easy once you've accepted stuff from or parts of this book or whatever. I mean, just look at that list of endorsers. Like that is not a representative sample of the beliefs of most people. Okay, this community is not a good place to be in. And when you're around people who think like that and talk like that, they're going to be saying those beliefs all the time. Eventually, you're going to start to like kind of open the door to those things. And people die from those beliefs every day. It is so reckless. Okay? There's no ancient wisdom or whatever. It's not like, oh, well, they didn't get vaccinated and they were fine. No, they died. Early and painfully. So, yeah, that's about all of this book that I can stomach. Maybe I should look that up. It's an absolutely terrible book. And no, I did not pay for this book. Uh-uh. Yeah, there was no fucking way I was going to give money to this reckless little sociopath. Are you kidding me? And shame on you, Rachel Hollis, for spreading this book and for calling it a good book. Absolutely shame on you. Okay, you'll be lucky if you don't have blood on your hands at some point. Okay, because there are real consequences to this shit. You should be ashamed of yourself. This is the worst thing you've ever done. It is. It's the worst thing you've ever done. I've been Mac. Peace out. Bye!